Based on research power, the School of Informatics, University of Edinburgh, is the UK leader in informatics research with an international reputation and unparalleled multidisciplinary breadth. The fundamental strengths are in foundations, programming languages, databases, system architecture, robotics, machine learning, artificial intelligence, and natural language processing. Over 115 academics and 130 research staff grouped in six overlapping institutes are working on numerous, often worldwide, projects.
So we have a lot of interesting projects running in the school. For example, we're involved in the Quantum Technology Hubs, which is a government program of building quantum computers which have completely different capabilities to classic computers. And in particular, we're responsible for looking at the software for such programs. And we have projects such as people looking at novel ways of building compilers for modern computer systems that have many different types of processors inside. So it's difficult to make sure that they behave efficiently, so then they're using machine learning to build the best compilers that they can.
And the idea is now that we have a collection of autonomous agents, and they can act within some environment that we specify, and we give them a task they have to solve together. And now they have to learn based on experience and trial and error from the ground up how to solve this collectively. And so we heavily use methodologies like reinforcement learning and others from the machine learning area. And ideally these agents, in, through time and through this process of trial and error, together converge to a joint solution that optimally solves some complicated task that requires them to coordinate their actions. So this is what we broadly refer to as multi-agent learning.
My research has to do with artificial intelligence technologies to support how humans collaborate. And we build this, what we call the workflows, which have to do with, you can think of them as cookbook recipes that describe how people are supposed to work together, and we can share and agree with them, and then computers can execute them to help collaborate the people together. We work closely with clinicians in the NHS to understand their everyday practices and what happens to the patient from the moment they step into the hospital until they get the exit. And we try to help them better understand the process and optimize it and find where the gaps are.
So one of the projects I'm trying to specifically work on is what is called explainable AI. The main problem is that, you know, machine learning nowadays is used in every app, in tons of applications, from biology, you know, detecting activity on the web which might be illegal, and so on and so forth. And it's also used to recommend people for jobs and so on. So one of the issues with machine learning is that the way it actually works is a black box. So people do not really know what's going on. So what I try to do is try to look into some of these techniques and understand how can we make them explainable, how can we give people the answer as to what exactly is going on, and in case they have further changes to make, how can you provide this back to the system and get the system to incorporate these changes.
I'm interested in applications of machine learning primarily in the area of energy, but most people don't have a very clear understanding of how much energy they're using. What percentage of your gas bill goes on the baths and showers, and what percentage goes on cooking, and what percentage goes on heating? Almost nobody has any idea. So what we're interested in doing is by putting sensors into the home that just measure simple things like temperature and humidity in rooms, can we infer what people are doing in the home? And that's all part of an effort to help people to save money and to reduce the amount of energy and carbon emissions that are happening. We're now moving on to look at applications, sort of related applications to do with social care. Again, with sensors in the home, what we're hoping is that we'll be able to keep people independent and with the right kind of assistance and out of hospital for longer than we can do at the moment.
Good example of how our research is bringing together lots of different kinds of big data is a project we have ongoing at the moment, which is to study autism. And in that project, we are trying to link together data that's generated in the clinical environment by doctors, psychologists, and the medical professionals, NHS, with individual patients with autism spectrum disorders, and all of the genetic information that goes alongside those. So a lot of money has been spent generating sequencing data and other information about what's going on at the molecular level in these patients, but often it's not been well linked to what's happening clinically. And so we believe that by integrating those two kinds of data together using special informatics methodologies, we can learn much more about what's happening in those patients and hopefully give the clinicians better ideas about how to stratify those patients and make decisions about how to treat them in the future.
One thing that I'm particularly excited about at the moment is try to understand how various bits fit together within cells. Now, the thing to be clear about is that we have huge experimental capabilities these days in terms of measuring lots of quantities, but each of them is essentially a flattened picture of what is a hugely multidimensional puzzle that goes on inside the cell. So what we see, maybe we will measure, say, the expression of the RNAs, and we will measure the state of the DNA, and we will measure other modifications. How do we piece them all together to understand how they actually work together from these multifaceted but single directional pictures that we get? So that's what I'm interested in. I use machine learning methods, and particularly I use something called probabilistic modeling, which involves formulating models of lots of random quantities and postulating how they might possibly interact, and then use the data to decide what seems to be the scientific hypothesis that is most supported.
We're involved in the Human Brain Project, which is a large European project. We're particularly interested in chemical signaling in the brain and how that works and how that relates to disease. But we've also got projects looking at the analysis of animal behavior, and that's involving spin-out companies where we're developing new products that allow you to see what the animals are doing at night when nobody's watching them.
One project that I'm really excited about these days is using machine learning to improve the design of computer systems, particularly how we can incorporate latest advances in machine learning technologies to make processors better, faster, more energy efficient, more higher performant.
We have developed some deep learning algorithms for forecasting mobile traffic consumption in mobile networks. So that is to say, we're trying to extract increasingly abstract features that have to do with the spatial, temporal correlations among traffic consumption. We observe the network for, let's say, up to 2 hours, and then we're trying to forecast mobile traffic consumption for up to 8 hours.
We currently have one project that's about trying to build a robotic hedge trimmer. This might sound simple, but in fact it's very complicated to make something that can go out, map a garden, and then work out how to operate itself to move around a garden and trim a hedge into different shapes. The projects that I'm quite excited about for myself at the moment include looking at how insects learn. People think of insects as kind of being very automatic behaving, but in fact the insects we look at include ants that can navigate using visual memory, so not using chemical trails or chemical cues, but by running through a complex environment, they can remember everything that they saw as they went along, and then if they want to follow that route again, they can use their visual memory to steer themselves along that route. So we've been trying to build computational and robot models that can copy what these ants are capable of doing.
I do computer animation. I mainly work for synthesizing character movements. So this is the main thing. We do lots of data-driven approaches. So we capture a lot of motion capture data and use the real human motion. We also use the dog motion database, and we try to produce a system that can interactively control the characters. So this is good for computer games, also for films. So when you want to design the films, you want the characters to move in some specific way, so the animators can design the movements of the characters and, like, you know, interactions between characters, interactions with the environment.
We have NASA Valkyrie robot here, and we focus on how to control the robot to move with legs. And in some narrow spaces, for example, the space station or the ground control station in Mars, for example, how the robot can use hands and arms and other body supports together with legs to move in these narrow spaces. Once you look at how the robot can repair the devices, for example, the solar panel.
So we are interested in trying to take robots into the operating theater so that they can take on roles like what surgical scrub nurses today have. So there might be a surgeon who's in the middle of an intricate operation. So one example of such a person is that we are collaborating with a neurosurgeon in the Edinburgh Hospital. And he tells me that a big problem he has is, on the one hand, the brain keeps filling up with blood, so somebody has to dab it and take it away. And on the other hand, because they make small incisions to enter these, it's typically very dark. So he needs a lot of helpers who are doing these little tasks. You know, can I dab blood and can I, you know, shine a torch? And all of this in a setting where the surgeon himself has to enter and do the task. So these operations tend to be pretty intricate, and we are curious whether we can, you know, alleviate some of this burden by having robots that can do part of this. But then that means that the robots have to be intelligent enough in a social sense to know when to interrupt, when not to interrupt, you know, how many times this person wants something done. It has to learn all of that from experience.
For the last number of years, a lot of my research has been around understanding the computational complexity of problems in both game theory and equilibrium computation problems in game theory and problems related to analyzing infinite state Markov decision processes and stochastic games. And both of these kinds of problems turn out to have commonalities, namely solving systems of nonlinear fixed point equations lie at the heart of these kinds of things.
One project that I have been working on for several years now is the Everest project. Mm-hmm. So it's named after a mountain that's pretty big, so it's meant to have a very ambitious goal. So what the project does is a verified secure implementation of TLS, which most people know as SSL or HTTPS. So it's what's used to encrypt communication on the internet. So when you communicate with your bank to do online banking, you're protected by the TLS protocol. So it encrypts the communication and it authenticates the bank towards you so that you know you're talking with the bank and not with an online criminal.
The project on incomplete data or uncertain data. This is something that exists all over the place. You have like any data set, any database you have out there in real life, you'll rarely have the data that you can trust completely. And the current technology is actually very ill-equipped to deal with data like that. So what we are trying to do, we are trying to see how we can increase the quality of answers that we get from database systems primarily.
We do some research with URLs. So if you look at all that training you get at work about, you know, how to spot a phishing URL or spot bad URLs, almost all of it says you should go mouse over the link and you should look at where it goes and decide whether or not you want to go there. And so we did some research to figure out, can people tell where it goes? And the answer is no. Only about 8% of adults can tell the difference between facebook.mobile.com and mobile.facebook.com, where I flip Facebook and mobile.
One project we're working on is a project to do with media monitoring that's called Summer, which is called the Scalable Understanding of Multilingual Media. And what that's about is taking feeds from the world's TV and radio and automatically transcribing them and translating them and extracting information from them to primarily help journalists do their job and to combine information from different sources and different cultures.
All right, now we are doing a project with Samsung where we're trying to build
translation systems that can also learn to translate between languages where we haven't actually seen any translations before. So normally we learn translations from languages, from data where you have the a source text and you have some translations that have been created by humans, and you have seen lots of those, then it's relatively easy to learn to translate. I'm saying relatively here. But if you haven't actually any of that data, it's a much bigger challenge, and that's one we are currently working on.
One project that's just finished, which I'm particularly excited about, was working with the University of Cape Town and trying to improve the quality of machine translation, translating in from South African languages such as Xhosa and Zulu into English. And the idea was to create an app on a phone, and that this would help medical doctors in Cape Town to communicate better with some of the patients that came from further afield in South Africa that move around and get access to healthcare in their own language.
I'm mainly working in computational social science. It's mainly actually trying to study some social phenomena from big data using data science, like how people behave online, what is trending in societies during some events like election, for example, what are people interested in, how people vote and how they act online, what are the signals, common different signals between people voting for a specific candidate, for example, how people behave during stressful events, and how what kind of social support they will get. So this is one part of what I'm doing. The other part is developing the technology about how to support this kind of analysis.
Project I've been involved in is building an agent that plays a board game called Settlers of Catan. Now, this is a very complex board game, win-lose game, and the players have to build settlements in cities, and the first to 10 victory points wins, and you get those points by what you build on the board and a few other things. But one of the things that the players have to do is negotiate over restricted resources. So this was a good environment for studying conversation when the goals of the people talking to each other conflict. So they lie, they obfuscate, they bluff, they conceal information. It was a fantastic environment for studying how people cope in those scenarios.
The most interesting projects I think we have at the moment are really more to do with humans talking to humans. One is where people don't have the ability to speak anymore, or they're losing this ability, and so they need to use a device to communicate. And of course, since speech is the preferred mode of communication, you'd like to give them a device that speaks. So we're doing that for people at the moment with motor neuron disease and other degenerative conditions. And our unique ability in that is to give them a personalized device. So they don't speak with a generic voice that comes with their phone. We give them a personalized voice that sounds like them.